I'm delighted to be here, and I just want to acknowledge I've been a part of CCASA for a very long time, and all of the many support avenues that they offer us are amazing. And I just would encourage all of you who are community advocates to take advantage of the many resources that they provide for us. And I want to thank them also for their active role in getting two bills passed this year that are supportive of survivors. You just are involved in many, many things. Now, wait a minute. For some reason, I got a second. I didn't. It said my screen sharing is paused, and I don't want that to happen. Okay. It really isn't.
Yeah. So what we see, Joyce, is we see your editing view, and we see something at a box at the top that says resume slideshow.
Okay. Resume share.
Okay. So now
did it come out right?
Now we just see a small sliver of your screen. There we go. There we go.
Okay. We have what we need.
We do, yes.
Yes, bear with me. I've done a few of these, but each time it seems to be a little bit different. And I just, the only housekeeping I would want to share is that I'm in my living room right in front of the picture window, and there is sometimes noise on the street out front. So if I mute, just bear with me and I'll come back as soon as the loud noise passes. So I want to talk about how we can use art in working with survivors. It looks like the majority of people are community-based advocates. And I just find that in 14 years I've been doing this, that art makes speaking about the subject of sexual abuse a little easier for people to hear. They are excited about seeing the art, and you can sandwich an awful lot of information in as you share the art. In 2008, I became aware of a little group that was trying to work with survivors, and it was called Finding Our Voices. And I became active with that group, and the next year started a nonprofit. And this is the mission that we have for the nonprofit Finding Our Voices. And we started out saying that we would have an annual art show. Within a year, we added support groups. Within a couple of years, we added art workshops, and some of the art workshops included writing. So we did publications of poetry for 4 years, and then we kind of paused it for a while, but we're doing it again this year. And this is the cover of the book that we're publishing this year of our writing group. And it not only has poetry in it this year, but it has some prose as well. And the cover is designed by one of our people, and all of the writing is writing that was submitted from the weekly writing groups that we started during COVID so that we could have more support for survivors than just annual art shows and monthly art workshops. And this is, these are a couple of, I should have done a better job of photoshopping the posters, but these are a couple of posters that we have for Denim Day. And we chose to postpone Denim Day until July, hoping that we could have a bigger crowd as we celebrate this. And I just would share with you now and a little bit more later that we are celebrating Denim Day in July this year, and we're doing it outdoors around a pavilion near Pioneers Museum. And we sold table sponsorships, and now we're selling tickets, and we will have a fashion show of survivors wearing denim, and get that will give us an opportunity to talk about the myths surrounding sexual assault. I want to go back and just give you an example of writing that shows how creativity can open up memories that are repressed. My own experience was that I had no idea. I knew I was a tearful child. I knew that I didn't grow up carefree and happy, but I always thought I had a pretty good childhood until my mid-50s when I had memories. But this particular myth that I wrote, I was in physical pain, and I read a pain control book that said to write a myth. And I didn't know what a myth really was, or I didn't think it made any sense to do it. But I went to Rampart Range, and as I listened to the water lapping against the shore, I wrote what they said was, write once upon a time and let the pen do the rest. And this is what came out 2 years before I had any memories of sexual abuse. Once upon a time, a little fish who loved to swim freely and recklessly ran into a brick wall because a little fish couldn't see as well as other fish. Editorial comment, I was legally blind in one eye and really poor sighted in the other as a child. Back to the poem, or the myth, all the others laughed and mocked the clumsy fish, even though earlier the fish had done some of the best flips of any fish in the pond. One time a brother fish purposely tripped the fish and made her look foolish. Another time, he dug his fins into her and shamed her. As time went on, the little fish won many awards as a beautiful swimmer, but she never really felt successful. She always believed she didn't measure up to the expectations of the fish around her. And I wrote in my memoir, tears streamed onto the paper when I wrote 30 at the end, a habit I learned in high school journalism. I judged the myth to be too short to be meaningful, but the pen wouldn't write another word. I placed it in the notebook with other exercises from the pain book. Maybe later I would write a real myth. And for me, that is just an introduction to the gentle way that any kind of creativity, and that could even just be baking bread or gardening. It doesn't have to be creating what we think of as an art. But there's something about creative activity that moves emotions. Emotions are, after all, something in motion. And stagnation and blockage contributes to angst rather than healing. So this is the first art piece that I did when I was in therapy. And I had vague dreams and flashbacks that convinced me that there was something sexual in my history, but I thought perhaps I acted out in high school or something. I didn't have any idea that it was within the family. But these were images I cut out of a magazine, and I just would highly recommend that to you as a way to get started with survivors. And if magazines seem to be a problem, we know that the Address Protection Program does not forward magazines. They have a lot of magazines, libraries, schools, and even just posting in your next door neighbor saying that you need magazines for a group, you can usually get a lot of magazines. And it's a very inexpensive way to start out with art. So again, I didn't know what these things meant necessarily. It just felt right to put them in. And then later I learned what they were referring to. In addition to having written a memoir, I wrote a companion book that is only about 15 pages long. Little girls are like kittens. They don't remember anything. And this is when I was 5 and the book was written. Little Girls was written when I was that age, and it's written in a child's voice. And I think that that expresses what I believe my family felt. That incest was a victimless crime that the little children wouldn't remember. And it was just a game or entertainment. So I cut my picture out, or my image out of the family picture, and then put it back in again after I'd done some healing. Marilyn Vandenberg was very pivotal in, can you hear that siren?
Yeah, but it's not too bad, Joyce.
Okay, thank you. I believe that our sexual abuse, when, regardless of whether we are aware of a lot of it or just brief insights, that it remains in the psyche until we deal with it. And that can be many different ways, but that we know that the first step in post-traumatic growth is acknowledging the injustice, and that the second step is then sharing it outside of yourself in safe places. So I think it stays in the psyche until we deal with it, and it stays in the body until it's released. And I talk about the abuse staying in the body until it's released because it takes movement. Release is an active verb, and it can be yoga, it can be massage, it can be physical therapy, it can be dance, it can be walking in the woods, but all sorts of movement can help us to get it, to intentionally get the angst and the discomfort out of our body. We know that from the ACE studies and all the follow-up of the adverse childhood experiences studies, that survivors of sexual assault in any form, or even if it's just exposure, and I shouldn't say just, because sometimes exposure to pornography is more damaging than the actual violation. Every violation is harmful and results in body responses. And trying to overcome the harm that comes after sexual violation needs to reach down into the body and release it from the cellular structure. I was doing my healing in the 90s, and that at that time it was kind of airy-fairy and not clearly supported by research that every cell in the body had memory. But now we know that is very, very true. So the more ways that we can move and move the angst out of our body, the faster we can heal. And the third point of my talk is always that the hard work of healing is worth the effort. And I say that because in working with survivors really since 1993, but with the nonprofit since 2008, there are so many people who say, I've known about your group for years, but I never came to the art workshops, or I never came to the writing workshops, because I've always been told that when you're around other survivors, it just makes it worse. And I don't know where that comes from. I find it a little disturbing, annoying, because survivors of cancer know that being with peers is important. Alcoholics Anonymous certainly has shown us that. So being with other survivors, if they are working actively and intentionally towards healing and towards recovery of their authentic self, can only inspire and encourage. So I do believe this is true. And process painting was what my facilitator called this kind of work. You may want to compare it to stream of consciousness writing. It is painting without the intention to do an image. You just dip your brush in some color that is appealing to you and make the movements that feel good in your hand and arm. You don't start out with the intention to paint a landscape or a flower or a sunset. Alice Miller is someone that you may be aware of because she has written so many books. Let's see, I was looking in my notes to see the names of some of them. I can't find that right now, but if you've read the, let's see, what are the names of those books? She is a researcher on the subject of childhood trauma. And I think most of us didn't know when we were going to school and studying psychology that she also was abused. And this is a book that you can get about that reveals the paintings that she did when she was healing from childhood abuse. And I think for many of us, what we go into, the field that we go into, has some origins and roots in our own personal experience.
Joyce, I'm looking at your notes here, and Drama of the Gifted Child, which was first published as Prisoners of Childhood, For Your Own Good, Not Be Aware, Banished Knowledge, which revealed her abuse as a child in 1988, Breaking Down the Wall of Silence. Those are the ones that you have listed. And then somebody in the chat box said it reminds them a lot of Centangle.
Yes. And I can tell you, thank you for sharing that about Centangle, because that's been one of the favorite workshops. About once a year we have a Centangle workshop because our survivors really like that.
For those who may not be familiar, Joyce, can you share a little bit more about what Centangle is?
We usually do little blocks, like coaster-sized blocks, and not necessarily concentric circles, but little blocks of shading. It can be of different colors, or it can simply be grayscale. But again, it is not an attempt to do a specific image of a bird or a tree, or it's more free flowing. And I always describe myself as a child who refused to color in the lines. I always preferred scribbling or doodling. Coloring within the lines doesn't resonate with me. I totally encourage and respect people who love adult coloring books, but they don't fit for me. Whoops, I went the wrong way. And just a trigger warning here, I will make some references that may be triggering, and those of you who are community-based advocates know that you bring yourself out of a triggering situation by focusing on one of your senses. So What do you taste? What do you smell? What do you hear? Will help to bring you into the present moment. My hair was once that color instead of gray. And we had a lean-to shed on the farm that was just above a hog pen. And so it was pretty muddy and murky and disgusting when I would fall out of that tree, when we would climb up on the roof of the lean-to shed. And then I seemed to be prone to falling, and I would sometimes fall off that roof down into the hog pen. And I think that's what that referred to. This again is about a farm scene. And my abuse went on from toddler to teens, and I think that frequently took place in outbuildings at the farm, barns or granaries, and they would wash me up in the horse tank. And I put some goldfish in the horse tank because I was so afraid of the goldfish. I really thought they would bite me. I remembered that. And then I would like for you to look at the monster and see that there is actually a nude woman under that monster. And I can say when I started painting this, the monster didn't have a head and a beak, just the body part. And I was just making random strokes with my paintbrush. And I had no idea what the green beetle and the fire was about. However, eventually I tell you this story not because you need to know what happened to me, but I hope you can follow the process of recovery of memories that set me free. And after I painted this, I confessed to a naturopath healthcare worker that I had had recurring bladder infections, and they could never determine them. It went on for 10 years. I took a daily antibiotic. I got scoped for kidney problems twice a year. And I had flashbacks to a drug that made me feel out of control. And eventually it came to me that that drug was Spanish fly, which was the aphrodisiac of the day. I'm really very old. And I share my age, not because you need to know my age, but because if you're in your 40s, 50s, 60s, or 70s, I want you to know there's life ahead, because I'm in my 80s. And I am more vibrant, and I am far healthier physically and mentally than I was 30 years ago, because I did my work. So as you work with survivors, just know that you are giving them a renewed zest for life as they deal with their demons and allow their flashbacks to come through and release that angst that goes along with denying our abuse. So back to the story. The naturopath said that the name of the drug Spanish fly is cantharis, and that she could give me homeopathic remedies for that. And after a series of three rounds of cantharis, I never in the last 30 years have had a UTI. Those urinary tract infections, because she said Spanish fly is residual in the kidneys. And I've talked to other contemporaries of mine who also had recurring UTIs from having Spanish fly being used as an aphrodisiac in those days. I don't know that we're far enough along to know what the long-term effects are of the drugs that are used to assist assaults today. After that, and I might share that the way I did my art was there was someone from out of state who came to Colorado Springs periodically to teach classes on spontaneous painting or process painting. And after I did that one, I didn't want to let anything come through. So I spent an entire 7 hours painting this picture, holding down anything that might be meaningful. And the next morning I came in and I started with the same colors because we used to do Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 3-day workshops. And I dipped my brush in red and this is what came out. And I think that we, as advocates and supporters of survivors, it's important to recognize the difference between rage and anger. Anger management is possible, but rage management kind of gets out of control, especially when we have denied rage. I know for my part, my two sons suffered my rage. I was a very compliant person, harmoniously worked with people both at work and at home, but insignificant little events would trigger explosive outbursts. And I think that when we have deep-seated rage, I just think it's very difficult to overcome that deep-seated rage without professional direction and facilitation. And for me, my therapist tried ever so many things, you know, the beating pillows, the hitting a punching bag, kicking tires, breaking dishes, none of that seemed to get to my rage, but painting with red did get to my rage. And after I did that, I really thought that that first rage painting took a long time, and it really only took 20, 30 minutes. And when I came back, the therapist or the facilitator said, reclaim your power now. And I painted this. And at that point in my healing, I only was aware of male. I knew that I had many offenders, but I was only aware of men at that point. So I said perverted studs. But I will share with you that that advocating with paintings and sharing an experience takes risk. And a risk that I always take if I am with a faith group, whether it is a synagogue, a church, Bible study group, I always share this particular painting because I think that sometimes faith groups start with forgiveness. And I think that that is short-circuiting the process. And research does support that feeling the injustice, feeling the anger, going through that darkness can open a door to real forgiveness that does release. Oprah says forgiveness is giving up any hope that the past could have been different. Other people describe forgiveness as a release or a breaking of the bond between the offender and the victim. Whatever definition you want to give it, having forgiveness of other people, of the offenders, before you recognize the pain that you are really experiencing is incomplete forgiveness. I could not feel, I felt the shame was all mine. And I think most victims do feel the shame is all theirs. And I have an example of what that shame meant to me. While you're looking at this picture, I will share that. My shame was so deep-seated early in my healing process that when my friend put his infant daughter in my arms, I cuddled the child to my chest and felt that warm glow we all feel with an infant. And then I suddenly remembered who I was. And as soon as I remembered who I was, the baby started to cry and I handed her back to her father. And I said, "How dare you let me touch this innocent child when I am so dirty?" And he said, "Joyce," and I said, "So dirty and shameful." And he said, "It's not your shame." And I said, "Oh yes, it is." And shame is just inexplicable to a survivor until they can reclaim the authentic self that they started out to be. And I do believe that art can help us get there. I want to share, I'm continuing to try to reclaim my power. And when I started painting this particular image, the first thing I painted was a red Mardi Gras mask on the right. And then I painted the chimney. And then I realized I was painting faces. And I have two brothers, one a year and a half older than me and one 8 years older than me. So on the left, you see my image above the two brothers. And I realized that on the right was my father, and the red Mardi Gras mask needed to be my mother. And I felt so incredibly guilty painting my mother with a red face. And as I painted, I remembered running up the stairs on our little farmhouse and screaming at my mother, "I hate your guts." And then I felt even more guilty. And within a week, I, in the presence of a therapist, had a flashback to my mother's active participation in my abuse. And that was when I realized that my offenders included both men and women. And I share that because it is hard for people to believe that a mother would abuse a daughter. It's also hard to understand how much guilt we carry until we can acknowledge what led up to, like I could acknowledge what led up to me telling my mother, "I hate your guts." And that's a horrible thing to say to a mother. It's also a horrible thing for a mother to abuse her daughter. So when someone says to me, "If I had a childhood like yours, I never want to know it," I acknowledge that that's a choice, but that the choice to know it is a choice that sets us free. Free from the shame and the guilt. I keep wanting to go backwards. And I really love this painting. I will share a bit of trivia. I am of an era gone by, but in my day, we talked of what you see in the center as bib overalls. And instead of talking about blue jeans, we called them belt pants. I wonder if anybody has ever heard the term belt pants, except me. But that's what it was in the 40s. And so I painted the overalls, and I grew up in the middle of Kansas, where there were a lot of snakes, and the fearful ones, of course, were rattlesnakes. I grew up on the farm where we grew wheat and milo and corn. And so the corn knife that you see strategically attacking male organs is the corn knife is has a curve at the top of the blade, so you can pull the ear of corn off of the green stalk. And we did have a boomerang at our house because I had an uncle who was in World War II, and he brought back a boomerang from Australia. And we had, during the war, when sugar was rationed, we sweetened things with honey. And so some of us in the family had been stung so many times by bees that we had really severe adverse reactions. So this was again an attempt to take back my power. And emotion is about motion. And of course in Kansas, we had a lot of wind, even worse than we have in Colorado. And shocking is a good description of flashbacks, but they also set us free. And I think that's the part I want to emphasize from my artwork. When I painted this particular painting, the person beside me said, "I can't believe you painted dogs in your abuse images." I too experienced dogs as a part of my abuse, but I've never told a soul, not even my therapist. And I was like, how's your therapist going to help you if you don't tell her or him? You can see here that the images of people run from a little toddler to a teen and everything in between. And I think the reason I show this painting, even though it's offensive to some people, is because I think it's important to understand that those who will abuse children will do things to make them feel subhuman. And I presented these paintings at the survivorship conference in Oakland, California a few years ago, where most of the people attending were victims of ritual abuse and mind control. And what they went through was even worse than this. And I think that we need to understand, we know that trafficking victims experience things that make them feel subhuman. And that's why recovery of your authentic self needs to be intentional, and we need to be persistent and really want to find what is at the root of our being. It's not an instant conversion and transformation. And healing goes up and down. As I wrote in my memoir, sometimes I question whether I'm climbing up the healing ladder or falling off. And I think that all of us as survivors of childhood abuse have that experience. And I like to share this because I want you to know, especially those of you who are community-based advocates, that you may be the one person who gives an individual, a survivor, hope. That we never know how far the ripples, and I have paragraphs about this in my book, you never know how far the ripples of your influence will reach. But this was painted, and I didn't know it when I painted it. I knew it shortly afterwards through flashbacks. The two amorphous figures in the bottom and the pure white image in the center refers to something that happened when I was 15 years old. I had a ruptured appendix, which in 1954 was pretty much a death sentence. And the country doctor who saved my life, I do believe, aborted a fetus as part of that process of saving my life from a ruptured appendix. I know that it was touch and go for a long time, and that we didn't have all the antibiotics and treatments that we have today. I had tubes dangling out of my incision, and we put yellow powder down those tubes to combat the gangrene. And he did save my life. And the reason I recognized his voice, and in the flashback, I heard him say, at first he swore and said, "We're in big trouble. This is already ruptured." And then later he said, "We have to take care of the baby inside this little girl." And of course, at 15, I wasn't 100 pounds soaking wet and was under 5 foot tall. And I didn't know where babies came from. I mean, you know, we didn't have that kind of health education in those days. Anyway, the doctor didn't stop there. He had his wife call my mother and convince her they needed a housekeeper. And I spent my last 2 years of high school in the home of this physician and his wife. And they saw to it that I went to college, said, I needed to go to school because I was a straight A student. And I said, "But my brothers didn't go." And they said, "But you need to." And took me down for the entrance exams, came down. The doctor came down on his day off to give me encouragement. His wife came down and took me to department store and bought me store-bought clothes. They didn't pay for my college education. In those days, you could work your way through. But they did what could be done in those days, because you know that there were no laws against childhood sexual abuse in the 50s. So each one of us doing what we can do can save a life. And all the masks, I think, are because I think anyone who has been severely traumatized feels like they're wearing a mask. And I was told to do a self-portrait, and I was feeling a lot of pressure because at that time, I still owned my fabric shop. I spent 10 years in public education, first as a home ec teacher and then as a counselor at the community college. And then I spent more than 20 years as a fabric and sewing machine retail store owner. And I was feeling the pressure of having one son in college, one son still at home, and trying to run the business and trying to heal myself physically and mentally. And I ended up walking away from that business, very successful business I'd had for more than 20 years, and from a 35-year marriage in order to find myself. So the phantoms that we deal with, I felt like I was going crazy, and I think anybody who represses trauma, whatever the trauma may be, once they get insights to the trauma, it is difficult to know whether you're going crazy. I in my memoir, I talk about this quite a bit, because I think it's the craziness feeling is pretty typical for survivors who have repressed their abuse. And again, I didn't start out to paint the little kneeling figure who is probably praying or meditating, or the little holly hobby looking image of a probably a toddler, or the monsters. Just played with the brush and these things came out. And healing does not go in an upward, straight upward line. You fall back. So there's loss, times when you're lost and times when you're found. And this kind of goes back to the Alice Miller images, because I learned after I painted this, actually many years after I painted it, I learned that children who are experiencing severe trauma or sexual abuse, physical abuse, living in the presence of alcoholism or mental health issues of their parents, will frequently paint disconnected body parts. And I felt very childlike as I did these stream of consciousness paintings. And this one I called disintegrating spirituality when I did it, because the father of my two sons was very conservatively religious. He considered, Proverbs 31 was seared in my memory, because every time I would get out of line, he would read me the qualities of a virtuous woman from the Bible. And he felt like because I was doing yoga and because I learned transcendental meditation, that I was participating in cults. And that didn't stop me, but it did give me pause. And I was so steeped in patriarchy. I talk about that in my book, that I was so steeped in patriarchy that I thought a woman came into this world to sacrifice herself for others. And if she didn't, she wasn't a virtuous woman. And it took a lot of counseling and a lot of meditating and a lot of personal searching my soul to overcome those patriarchal cultural trainings that we just absorb from our caregivers. So this was a symbol of hope for me. Living in Colorado, of course, I saw the hummingbirds, and this was an image that reminded me of them. And I just wanted to share that. Sometimes I start my speech out this way, but I don't want to miss the opportunity to share with you that, you know, my growing up in the middle of Kansas, I soon learned from my caregivers, my parents, the people around me, that if you wanted to have friends and you wanted to be successful in life, there were three things you didn't talk about, and I'm sure you know them. You didn't talk about religion, sex, or politics. And then as I grew into adulthood, I became aware of Martin Luther King, and we all know that he said injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. But the thing that struck me deeper was when he said, our lives begin to end the day we become silent about issues that matter. And that kept coming back to me as I went through my healing process. And I decided that I couldn't be silent about the issue of childhood sexual abuse, that I wasn't going to be silent about what mattered to me and what matters to so many people who are, through circumstances, silenced. So painting goes on. And I like to share that when I painted this, I tried to make those demons be my brothers or my father. My father, who shared me with soldiers, my body, shared my body, not my soul, but shared my body with soldiers from Fort Riley, which was nearby our farm. I tried to make it the minister. The book I wrote, Little Girls Are Like Kittens, they don't remember anything. That's a comment my father made to the minister after he used my body. And my father said, don't worry, little girls are like kittens. They don't remember anything. And I think that they did consider it a victimless act. So struggle as I couldn't identify, as I might, I couldn't identify who these demons that were burning, and it was fun to paint the fire, I gotta tell you. I suddenly, finally realized, actually not suddenly, it took a while, but I realized the real demons in healing are your own self-judgment and self-reproach, your shame, your regret. And if you can overcome those things and forgive yourself, it's really harder to forgive yourself, not only for being a participant in this violation, because your body is hardwired to respond, and it does. And because offenders seem to have a knack for saying things that make us take on the shame. So if you can really say that I forgive myself for being a part of this, and I forgive myself for denying it all these years, and I forgive myself for the people I harmed along the way with my explosive rage that I didn't know where was coming from, if I can forgive myself for the addictions that I may have used to try to put down the pain, forgiving yourself is so important. And I do believe that currently, when in 2000, there was virtually nothing said about self-compassion. Now there are hundreds and hundreds of studies on self-compassion. And the two people that I like to follow on the subject of self-compassion, and you can find YouTube videos and books and all sorts of information free or for purchase on the web from Tara Brach, T-A-R-A-B-R-A-C-H, and from Kristen Neff, K-R-I-S-T-E-N-N-E-F-F. Tara Brach and Kristen Neff both talk about self-compassion. And I think that overcoming the shame and the regret and the self-judgment with self-compassion is an important element of healing. So the tools that I use to heal look pretty phallic, and that's okay, because that's a part of who I am. It just doesn't define me. In post-traumatic growth, we learn that we can incorporate the strengths that we developed during our abuse, we can use to become more whole and more confident and more competent and more compassionate for ourselves and others. So I want to share with you again a little bit more about finding our voices, because my life revolves around finding our voices. And we have helped hundreds of men and women since 2008. And this is the cover of our program, Healing Hearts Through the Arts, that we did in April. We have an art show during the month of April, and we work with a local gallery that lets us have our survivor up the entire month of April. And I just want to point out that the infant dress and bonnet on top left and the fan quilt on top right is made on window screen. And what you really can't see in this image that there is incorporated in this sculpture barbed wire. And in addition to these two items, there was a cheerleading outfit, a wedding dress and veil, and a young girl's dress. So there was a series of many sculpted items that had something beautiful to look at from a distance, but when you got up close, you saw the barbed wire, and it was a powerful image of what is beyond what we usually see. And this year, because in 2020 April, or no, October of 2020, we had one of our art workshops on writing, and we had so much enthusiasm, we started meeting weekly just to write. And of course, during the pandemic, we wanted to offer more opportunities for survivors to at least see each other on Zoom. And we have continued that. And so we had a writing wall, and from that writing wall, in our April exhibit, we have compiled a book that we will sell at our Denim Day event on the 29th of July. And these are a couple of things that were on our writing wall. So this is a little flyer about our event that's going to be happening in a couple of weeks. And we chose the theme, Celebrate, Liberate, Elevate. These are some of the jeans that we embellished during our art workshops, and these jeans will be worn by survivors at the denim event. And I just would encourage you to experiment with the survivors you work with in terms of doing collage, painting, writing, doing poetry, because I just don't think that there'll ever be enough governmental programs and institutional programs to serve all of the survivors that are out there. We know the numbers are phenomenal. And what do we know about the pandemic? Well, I think it was in Child USA, I read that in comparing the end of the year 2017 and 18, so this was before the pandemic, but it was during a time when even in our political situation, we saw there was very little support for survivors. So from end of year report of rapes in 2017 and 2018, those reported to police reduced by 25%. Those self-reported rapes went up 40%. So the huge gap that's occurring indicates how little faith we have in, I want to go forward, not backward, how little faith we have in the criminal justice system to support survivors. And if we as advocates can support the survivors in doing their healing and not feeling that they have to report. I mean, we see the abuse that happens when survivors report to the justice system. And CCASA has wonderful programs on educating us about restorative justice. And I personally argued with Pete Lee, our representative in Denver, and told him it would never work for sexual abuse survivors. And that was 10 years ago. Today, I say, I think it might work for survivors because I've seen hundreds and hundreds of survivors who will not report to police or police department or attorneys their abuse because they don't want to put their family member in prison. But they would love to have an apology. They would love to have some help with their therapy. They would love just to be acknowledged that they have endured something traumatic. So I think that there is a place for restorative justice if the offender actually meets the requirements, and that includes some remorse for what they have done and an acknowledgement that what they have done is harmful. So I have advocated in many places over the past 15 years. And it's not important that you know what I've done, but just to know that as you do little things, each one impacts different people and you don't know how far those ripples will reach, but you might just through any of your advocating reach someone who will someday sit on a jury, and it will make a huge difference in some survivor's experience. So I wanted to share some collages that led up to my publishing of my memoir. I said I would do it before I was 80, and I just barely got it done. But I think a lot of survivors feel like they're not enough. And Marissa Peer in London, who is a therapist to the rich and famous, says that not enough is a universal disease. And it doesn't matter how worldly successful you are, that she finds the rich and famous also feel they're not enough. And we witness that when we hear about their suicides or their drug addictions. Then I did this, My Recovery is an Open Book. And the significant statement on the right is, I had every reason to write the truth. And I do believe that we have a right to write. I believe that as women, it's really important that our stories be written and shared, because we don't even have a word in our language for women's history. It's all his story. We don't have her story. We just have history. And I think that when men record history, they record something different than women. And we need both so that we have balance. And the memoir I wrote is Beyond Aftershocks. And it is not, I don't go into a lot of detail about my abuse. I think the important part that I wanted to share is that healing is possible, and that there are many different avenues that you can use on your healing journey. And what you're really after, I think it is Peter Levine who says that trauma results in a loss of self, and that evidence of recovery is a reclaiming of self. And you can well imagine, you know, that you get some accolades for the work you do, and you also get some criticism. And when you write and put it out there publicly, you definitely get lots of criticism. So having some affirmation of my writing felt really important. And I share it just because I want to say to you, let yourself be aware of the accolades you get and not just the complaints. And I love this statement from Picasso. So what I want to share in conclusion is that what I mean by healing or what I mean by recovery. I said in my memoir that empowering survivors has given meaning to my abuse and purpose to my retirement. And what I believe is recovery of self is living with physical vitality, with mental clarity, with emotional stability, and with an enduring spiritual connection with the God of your understanding. So I thank you for your time, and I would at this point welcome questions.
Thanks, Joyce. We do have one question that came in earlier when you were talking about process painting. Lisa asks, were there therapists available at the process painting classes?
Actually, some of the people in the class were therapists doing their own work. And the facilitator was both an artist and a therapist. So that is a really good question, and it's something that we have considered as we offer monthly art workshops over the last 14 years, 15 years. We always try to have a therapist there. I am not a qualified therapist today, but I have been a school counselor. And so I have a master's degree in that area. And sometimes I've been the only one, but I think that it is good judgment to try to have a therapist when there are art classes. Generally, when we always have a grounding at the beginning of our art classes where we do some kind of meditation, maybe progressive relaxation or visualization of some sort that kind of gets people into the room and helps them to leave all their struggling that it took to get there behind them. And then at the end, there is an opportunity to share if they are comfortable doing so. And if there is someone who is triggered, that's usually when it occurs, is during the sharing. We have had people break down, maybe have some tears or giggling, some kind of a response as they are doing their art project. But more often it comes during sharing, and it is very helpful if you have a qualified person in the room who can take that individual aside and work with them until they feel comfortable. Other questions?
The next one is really just, can you show the Picasso quote again, just to be able to finish reading it? So if you could go back a slide, Joyce. And then we just have a couple of comments that have come in. One says, this was incredibly powerful, Joyce. You seem to say everything I believe. Every man, woman, and child deserves to be heard. And then we had someone who had to sign off a bit early, but said, it's as always, it's always wonderful and empowering to hear you speak. So that's kind of what we have going on in the chat box right now, Joyce. Folks, if you have questions, if they're coming up, we'll give it a second here for you all to continue thinking about and typing your questions. While folks do that, Joyce, is there anything else that you'd like to leave folks with about creative advocacy or doing this work or anything at all that you'd like folks to walk away from this with?
I would have a request that you put in the chat what do you think that you would be most apt to use in your work for yourself or for your agency of the things that I've talked about today? And let's see, what would I like to leave you with? You know, this is the first ever fundraiser Finding Our Voices has had, and I can't tell you how scary it was to say, we're going to try to do a community-wide fundraiser where we sell tickets. And because, you know, who wants to come find out about sexual abuse? And I think it's going to be a very successful event, but it's like, it's taking a risk. And I think doing any of this art is taking a risk as well. And I would just encourage you, if you think doing a painting project or a collage is beyond what your group is ready for, experiment with just two or three people. And then reach out to more. I just would encourage you not to let fear or hesitation stop you, because we really are, as human beings, we really respond to creative activities favorably. And another thing that I would encourage is that you work together. That I think it's so important that Finding Our Voices never thinks of CCASA as competitive or as Blue Bench or any of the rape crisis centers. This is not competition. This is trying to support each other, find out what the other organizations and groups, find out what the churches are doing for sexual assault survivors and work together with them. One of the things we've tried to do with this denim event that we're doing on the 29th of July is reach out, because racism is such a huge issue in our world today. And as a white, blue-eyed, Caucasian, I don't even know how to talk properly about it, but we have reached out to LGBTQ and we have participation of a couple of groups. And we have table sponsors who said, I don't really have an organization, I just want to give to you and I'll sponsor a table. So then we gifted that to these groups and said, please bring your banner. Please model for us. We want survivors wearing their denim outfits so we can talk about the increased risk for the disabled, for those who have gender issues, for those who are Black, Indigenous, or people of color. And we have one individual who is sponsoring three tables for Black groups, and we are delighted to have a group that works on in among that. We have the Black History Group sponsoring a table, and we have a group of individuals that are working with the human trafficking for Black individuals. And this is one way that we can reach out and say, we want to be inclusive of Latino, Latinx, Hispanic groups. We want to be inclusive of Asian. We want to be inclusive of all the different groups that we have in our community to show that we understand sexual abuse is not a respecter of any subset, whether it's education, affluence, career. We find sexual abuse throughout all parts of our society. And so as an organization that serves survivors, we are trying to be more intentional than we've ever been about being inclusive.
Thanks so much, Joy. Joyce, a couple of people mentioned in the chat box that, so one said, I like the idea of providing a free flow painting class for our clients once a month. Another person mentioned, I actually use every part of those, writing, poetry, art, prose, and speaking, that their work is very similar to yours. And then just a lot of thank yous in the chat box for sharing your expertise, your story, your experience with us this morning. Someone did ask for contact information for Joyce. I put that in the chat box. It is here on the PowerPoint slides. You will be getting a copy of those PowerPoint slides here shortly after with some redactions, but contact information will be there. It'll also be included in the body of the email. So just, you know, lastly, want to again thank you again, Joyce, for spending this time with us this morning and your very, very busy schedule, and for you to share this information with us has been really great, and we really appreciate it. We also appreciate you all being here and joining us this morning. Just a few quick announcements before we go. Any questions that you have that pop up after we are no longer on the webinar, feel free to reach out to Joyce, feel free to reach out to me. I can get those questions to Joyce as well, so you can get your questions answered. Look up for that follow-up email, like I mentioned, that I'll be sending here in just a bit, with contact information, PDF, all of that fun stuff. We also will have a link to a survey that's really helpful for us in knowing what other topics you all are interested in learning about during our webinars. There's also a question that is helpful for Joyce as we share those results with our presenters as well. So please do keep an eye out for that and complete the survey. We do have another webinar this month on restorative justice that Joyce mentioned, that CICASA is doing a lot of work around that. It's a second in a series. It's called Fostering a Shared Understanding of Power Consciousness as a Foundational Element of Restorative Practices. That'll be on the 27th at 9:30, and will be presented by Sarah Silvas-Burstein and Jenna Harper, both from CICASA. We hope to see you all at another webinar soon or at another training with CICASA. A big thank you all to you all again. And also thank you, Joyce. We'll see you all soon.
Thank you.